Lord be with you. Happy Super Bowl Sunday. In case you hadn't heard, Jesus is going to return on Super Bowl Sunday. So just think of all those people that skip church on Super Bowl Sunday, which we have a lot. Wouldn't they much rather stand before the Almighty and say, I was in church when it happened? A couple of deaths to report. Sally Snyder died early Saturday morning. He's been very ill the past 2 weeks and in the hospital at St. John's, at Mercy. And they sent him home. I saw him in Mount Vernon. I saw him Wednesday here at the hospital. And I was also at the veterans' home on Thursday, and he had been brought back there already. And then early Saturday morning, he died. It's sad, but boy, he was in bad shape at the very end. Another death, Marilyn Boston's aunt, Eva Dial, died, 93 years old, lived a good life, Marilyn says, but she died yesterday. Our gospel text, we're journeying through Epiphany, and of course we're finding out who the babe born in Bethlehem was. Today we have a text that tells us that Jesus is one who has authority over evil spirits. He has authority over evil. Our Old Testament text is about Moses' farewell address and his promise to his people that God will raise up prophets among them so that they will not be leaderless. And we're going to look at that and prophets and what that means for us today. Let's prepare our hearts for worship through the brief order of confession and forgiveness found on page 3 of your bulletin. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who spoke light into creation, who calls us to listen and follow, who sends us to shine like stars.
Amen.
Let us come before God, confessing our sin. Holy and merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against our sisters and brothers and against you. We cherish the values of this world. We cause others to stumble. The earth is wounded by our excess. Have mercy, O God. Forgive us, renew us, and raise us up on eagle's wings, that we may do your will with courage and delight. Amen. Hear the voice from heaven. You are my own, my beloved. God gives power to the weary and strengthens the powerless. Be cleansed, be healed. For in the name of Jesus Christ, I declare to you the forgiveness of your sins and the revealing of God's reign. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Share God's peace by greeting those around you. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Be with you. Compassionate God, you gather the whole universe into your radiant presence and continually reveal your Son as our Savior. Bring wholeness to all that is broken and speak truth to us in our confusion, that all creation will see and know your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
I could see what life reading from Deuteronomy. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, if I hear the voice of the Lord my God any more or ever see this great fire, I will die. Then the Lord replied to me, they are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods or who presumes to speak in my name, a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge, but anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom all things and for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge. Since some have become accustomed to idols until now, they still think of the food they eat as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us closer to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you who possess knowledge eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience when it is weak, you sin against Christ. Therefore, if food is a cause of their falling, I will never eat meat, so that I may not cause one of them to fall. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come up. Here's Zach sitting right next to me, so you can see this. Hey, there you go, kid. What do you think of that picture? Yeah. Do you think they look mean, or do you think they look kind? Kind, you think? How about everybody else? I think they look a little spooky. This was painted in 1912. And it was painted, the author was painting Jesus' encounter with the man in the synagogue. And the man in the synagogue had an unclean spirit, a mean spirit. And Jesus told the spirit to leave. And he left the man, and everyone was astounded. That tells us the good news in that is Jesus has authority even over the mean, ugly, unclean things. Scary things. You ever wake up in the middle of the night and get scared? Never? Oh, you never wake up in the middle of the night. How about, we used to have a spooky basement. And we used to have, I would have to walk quite a ways into the basement, and there was a light that you pulled to turn it on. And there you were walking in the dark. And I always thought that was a spooky moment. Never knew what was in a spooky basement. But I used to always take comfort in the fact that I belong to Jesus, okay? And that no matter what happened, even the spooky things, Jesus had power over them, okay? So that's the good news today. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he has authority, even over the evil things. Help us to trust you through him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go back to your seats. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. N.T. Wright was bishop in Great Britain, and he's written 137 books. Can you imagine that? In one of those books, in fact, I tried to find the quotation to this week, but I just couldn't. But he tells the story of getting into a cab, and the cab driver starts talking with him and finds out that he's a theologian, a bishop of the church. And when they came to a stop sign, the cab driver turned around to him and indicated that he was a believer and made a statement about the resurrection that was a rather profound statement. And the effect it had on N.T. Wright was, he said, "I danced with that thought for a very long time. I danced with that thought for a very long time." He was showing us that words are powerful. They can build up and they can tear down. Words are powerful. An example of that is Henry Nouwen. Henry Nouwen, if you remember, was born in the Netherlands, became a priest, went on and became a psychologist and theologian, a professor at Notre Dame, Yale, and Harvard. And when he neared retirement age, he shocked everybody by quitting academia and moving to Canada and living as a worker in a home for mentally disabled adults. People, of course, thought he was wasting his life. But he said this of that experience: "I would like to speak to you about the spiritual life as the life of the beloved. As a member of a community of people with mental disabilities, I have learned a lot from people with disabilities about what it means to be beloved. Let me start by telling you that many of the people that I live with hear voices that tell them they are no good." Now, they aren't hearing voices in their own minds. They're hearing voices because people are saying, "You are no good." That they are a problem, that they are a burden, that they are failures. They hear a voice that keeps saying, "If you want to be loved, you had better prove that you are worth loving. You must show it." Then he writes, "But what I would like to say is that the spiritual life is a life which you gradually learn to listen to a voice that says something else." And here he repeats that voice of Almighty God that was spoken upon Jesus when he was baptized, the voice that I use to introduce the absolution this morning, a voice that says, "You are the beloved, and on you my favor rests. You are the beloved, and on you my favor rests." He often talks about how he would constantly reaffirm that with the people, that you are God's beloved, on you God's favor rests. And even talks one day about a young woman who seemed to always be so needy. And she came to him one day, though, and said, "Henry, you are the beloved, and on you God's favor rests." And he said that was profound, had a profound effect on him. Well, that's a word from God. We could even say it's a modern-day prophecy. We're going to talk about prophets and prophecy today, and we'll get to that. First, let's look at Moses. Moses is giving his farewell address in Deuteronomy. It's the entire book of Deuteronomy is his farewell address. He's saying goodbye. The reason he's saying goodbye is, if you remember, he disobeyed God. Did a simple thing, simple disobedience. There was a rock, and God said, "Wave your staff over the rock, and water will come out of the rock." And Moses just became so angry at the people that he took his staff and he hit the rock. Water came out, but God took Moses aside and said, "Moses, I said over the rock, don't hit the rock. And as a punishment, you cannot enter the promised land with your people." Now the people knew this, and they were a fickle people, a frightened people, and they knew without Moses, they would be lost. And they didn't want to be so close to God that they would hear God's voice, because they were just extremely fearful of God also. So Moses was giving them these words of comfort. "Don't worry. From now on, God will raise up prophets from among you that will speak his word to you." And he gave some basic tools for determining whether or not what they say is from God or not. For instance, a prophet does not speak arrogantly. A prophet does not speak for profit, for money. A prophet doesn't speak in the name of other gods. In fact, in our gospel text, why does Jesus silence the unclean spirit that says, "You are the prophet of the Most High God"? Jesus silences that spirit because it is not in the name of Almighty God. And therefore, the unclean spirit was somehow trying to take advantage of Jesus. Have you ever known someone to always have nicknames for people? In a sense, that's rising above them and controlling them a little bit. But Jesus wouldn't let that happen. That was a false word. And a prophet tells the truth. And we know there's a long history of prophets. The people of Israel wanted a king. And the reason they wanted and God Almighty wanted to be their king. The reason they wanted to be the king is they just needed something, someone who they could see as an authority that would give them direction. And of course, the history of Israel is one in which they had the prophets. Well, and then God relented and gave them the judges. And then finally, God relented and gave them kings who didn't always fare well, did they? The prophets continued to walk alongside of the kings and always be there to correct the people, to give a word from God. And often the words were harsh words of judgment, but there was always a word of comfort with it. If you remember Isaiah, who was very harsh, telling the people it was their unfaithfulness that led them to being captured by the Babylonians and brought into exile. We have those words during Advent. "Comfort, comfort, my people," says our God. Words of comfort. Let's now go to the New Testament. The Apostle Paul tells us that we all have the Holy Spirit. And we all, as God's believers, have a gift, if not gifts, of the Spirit. If you don't know what your gift is, well, we have tools to help you discern that. Very often, it is the community of faith that helps us discern what our gifts are. Someone said, how can you tell if you're called into the ministry? What do the people in your church think, right? So the Apostle Paul considered prophecy to be one of those gifts. And he's most clear about that in the book of Corinthians, although he talks about it in Romans, he talks about it in Ephesians, prophecy. It's good that the Corinthian church was a troubled church, because then the Apostle Paul can speak what's on his mind more clearly to us. And he talks about everyone should follow the way of love, he writes, and eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. The one who prophesies, he says, speaks to people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. The one who prophesies edifies the church. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, so that the church may be edified. Everything, he says, everything must be done so that the church may be built up. Now, we have examples of bad prophecy that has gone on. You may recall, I believe it was back in 2006. Oh, it was even earlier than that. Right shortly after 9/11, when the planes hit the Twin Towers, Jerry Falwell and Pat Robertson, what was their prophetic statement? That God did this because our country was beginning to accept gays and lesbians. How did we determine whether or not that was right? Well, the community of the faithful immediately said, excuse us, but that seems a little weird. Jerry Falwell, I know, retracted what he said. I don't remember if Pat Robertson did. But prophecy, good prophecy, edifies, builds up. The great value of prophecy to the church today, let me quote, is the contemporary word of God to encourage and guide his people. The prophetic message is a word fitly spoken directly from God for the good of edifying as it fits the occasion, that it may impart grace to those who hear. Good for edifying as fits the occasion, according to Ephesians 4, that it may impart grace to those who hear. Now, why do I bring this up? I know I'm preaching on a subject that everyone's going, oh, Pastor Dan, you're sounding a little weird. Let me give you an example. Back in a congregation I served, we were contemplating building a building. We knew we needed to build a building, and we looked for suitable land. A piece of land that was the most suitable cost, we were going to buy 7 acres because that's what the owner of the property wanted to sell, $33,000. That was a bargain. Of course, a building expert from the ELCA came out, and he said, oh, it's a hill. And it was a gradual hill up, and it would have been, and there was a 7 acres, about 4 or 5 acres of flat land up on the top. But he said, well, you need to get a civil engineer and find out how much it will cost to flatten this hill. And my thought was, what are we, Walmart or something, that we flatten hills in order to build a building? But nonetheless, we all said, okay. We hired the civil engineer, and he gave his report to a congregational meeting. And he said it would cost $150,000 to flatten that hill. Well, that was pretty much a deal breaker for us. even though we still couldn't buy a piece of land for $150,000. And so there was a lot of discussion going on, and, oh, this is terrible, what are we going to do? And finally, Bill Stewart, who's now deceased, Bill Stewart stood up, and he simply said, if God wants a church on that hill, there will be a church on that hill. And all of a sudden, everyone goes, oh, yeah. This is about God, isn't it? It's not about us. It's about God. And if God wants a church on that hill, there will be a church on that hill. Ever since then, my immediate reaction was, Bill, did you know you were a prophet? That's a word of prophecy, a word of encouragement. People, you're thinking of the wrong thing if God wants to build this. And ever since then, I always look for prophets among us, someone who's going to say that encouraging word that builds us up, that's extremely helpful. You know where I really look for it? At annual meetings. Do you know why? Annual meetings are usually so brutal. I look for a word from God. And I actually heard one last Sunday at our congregational meeting. Want to know who the prophet was? A word of encouragement. First, a word to let us know that we weren't on the right track. And that, by the way, it came from the mouth of Don Harkey. And I thought when he said it that he was unusually pensive about what he said. He wasn't as bold as he normally is. But he, after Brian Wogan gave us a wonderful presentation on how healthy financially we are, never in Brian's 7 years at Messiah have we been this financially healthy. And that's when Don said, very good report, but I've thought for the past few years we have been too finance-driven. Don't you think that's true? Too finance-driven. He said, now we have an opportunity to do something where we are at our best, and that's to be mission-driven. We used to talk a lot about that, being mission-driven. Also, I had a conversation this week with someone who's been around Messiah longer than I have, and he said, mission-driven, what does that mean? I go, well, don't you remember us talking about that? I seem to have talked a lot about it. No, I don't know what that means. And I go, well, maybe we need to re-educate people on what it means to be mission-driven. So that's what we're going to do. Talk about mission and how we as Messiah Lutheran Church really do best when we remember our mission and constantly become driven toward mission. Now, I don't want Don to get a big head thinking he's the only prophet among us. God's Spirit, Moses promised that God would raise up prophets. And of course, the man with the evil spirit looked at Jesus and said, you are the Holy One of God. And we know Jesus is one who God raised up. He was a prophet among us in the sense that he lived God's word. His life was a demonstration of God's word. His words were God's word. His death was God's word spoken to us, his resurrection. Why? To encourage us, to send God's Spirit to us, to let us know we are never alone, to let us know that we are the beloved in whom God takes delight. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead.
Called to know, love, and follow you, O God, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You guide the prophets.
Inspire your church to speak with authority and to act with strength where the powers of evil are most oppressive and human hearts yearn for dignity and compassion. Lord, in your mercy.
Gracious Creator, you have made us to care for the creation you have given us.
Drive out the demons of greed and carelessness that wound creation through pollution and overuse. Lord, in your mercy.
Send prophets of wisdom and courage to our nation.
Move us beyond partisan divisions to a common search for liberty and justice. Lord, in your mercy.
Healer of our every ill, bring hope and solace to those who struggle with health and wholeness.
Visit the sick with your compassionate spirit, especially Jane Allward, Pamela Sinquini, Kelly Colwell, Nikki Fuller, Tiffany Giles, Randy Greenwood, the Reverend Maynard Hansen, Dustin Jones, Jim Lampe, Sue Lee, Pat Morrison, Nancy Niewald, Margaret Peterson, Louise Snyder, Pearl Spots, Wayne Sproul, Mary Thomas, Cynthia Tulin, Janice Trotter, Joe West, and Ed Wood. Are there any others?
Eternal God, the faithful who have died listen to your voice, and you freed them to live in love for you.
Open our ears to hear you and follow their example of faith and courage as we pray for those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Suzanne Noe, of Ramona Vaughn, of Solomon Snyder, and of Eva Dial. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Trust in your love and healing, O God. We commend to you all for whom we pray, knowing you will hear and answer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. On the hill,
we're gathered together to become one bread. So let your church be gathered together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. For yours is the glory through Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give the thanks and praise.
It is our duty and delight that we should everywhere and always offer thanks and praise to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, who is your light made manifest to all the nations. And so with the church on earth, all creation and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. power and might. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in your name. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, O holy God. You are the life and light of all. By your powerful word, you created all things. Through the prophets, you called your people to be a light to the nations. Blessed are you for Jesus, your Son. He is your light, shining in our darkness and revealing to us your mercy and might. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. By your Spirit, bless us in this meal, that refreshed with this heavenly food, we may be light for the world, revealing the brilliance of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, both now and forever. Amen. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come.
Mercy on us, Lord.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Everlasting God, we bless you that you have brought us to the mountaintop and fed us with the life and light of your Son. Send us in his name from this place to bring light into dark corners, healing where lives are torn, and nourishment to every hungry heart. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen.
Even though there's pain there, that is music to my ears, young children. Please note that there's a sign-up sheet. There's a pad at the welcome table to sign up if you would like to receive one of the books, our Lenten books. It is called Surprised by Hope. It is by N.T. Wright, and it's about hope and about the mission of the church.
guided by the gospel, we welcome all worship, make disciples, hunger for ministry,
nurture youth, gather resources for growing ministries, offer healing and care to all in need.
Share news.